So we have a wonderful time with our animals, and we want to keep them on this earth in exactly the same homes and habitats as they are used to. And so all of us have to help keep the cities away from them and take care of the animals so that they are part of the whole cycle of life, from us on down to the amoeba, a one-cell animal. Are there any questions? Oh, yeah.
One of the really cool things about growing up with mom as your mom is that, one, we got to raise all the animals, so sometimes you'd have a crow knocking on your window to come in, sometimes you'd have a raccoon in your bed when you went to sleep, and sometimes you would have an owl that wanted to take a shower on your shoulder in the morning. But also, she took us to places where, you know, things were happening that were very special and might not happen again. So she took us to see rainforests, and one year she went out to where the sandhill cranes
are. It kind of looks like
that. And this is what she could do, because her brain works like this. Not too many people do.
That's the whole entire.
This is what she would do on vacation. She would take these books, and she would start at that end and unfold them and do as sort of a mural the entire trip.
You hear the cranes coming to bed, standing in the river, Platte River, all
the
night.
Platte River.
And then in the morning where Twig is flying off to the fields to eat.
So that's how she would kind of get a story in her head. And this became, I don't know if any of you have seen it, but a book called Luck. Have you seen it's a picture book called Luck? Yes.
Yeah.
So,
now, if you have any questions, we'd like to answer them. There's one. Yeah.
You probably got, from having a baby raccoon, that's where you got Jesse Coon James, right?
From having a raccoon is probably where you got Jesse Coon James.
Yes, exactly.
Thought so.
Yeah. And Frightful was my brother's beautiful peregrine falcon named Ulysses. He went to high school with him, college, and was on his way to get his PhD when some of the ferrets got loose and killed him.
Ferrets? Where? Like the other people at ferrets?
Yeah, one other student was the ferret. He said, don't keep them in the same courtyard, but he did. And that was nature working.
What?
That's what ferrets do.
No, what?
Oh, the ferrets killed the bird.
Where did you get the idea for the watermill and the nutcrusher?
Where did you get the idea for the watermill and the nut crusher?
In the
far side. In the far side. Not
far side. Well, coming into Rensselaerville, there was the watermill with the big one wheel. It's no longer there, I noticed. And the nutcracker was my father's idea. He used to crack nuts that way.
What are you doing?
So everything in these books we've done, and we know what they're like, and it's such fun doing them. And now it's becoming so important for all of us to understand nature and help out the earth, keep it as beautiful as it is. Do all of you live around here?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow.
I do.
You have a beautiful part in the world.
Raise your hand what you would like to kind of do.
Anybody else have any other questions? In the back.
Can you tell us what it was like to work with Hollywood on the movie version of My Side of the Mountain? We were very upset about Frightful in the movie.
Awful. You write a book, and then Hollywood buys it and wishes you would drop dead. So they got stuck on how to end it and wouldn't accept the fact they couldn't stay there. So they decided to have a hunter shoot Frightful. Which is, but in the, my, on the far side of the mountain, Frightful's very much alive. And then the last book in this series, Frightful, he is free and flying over the woods and the Catskills and the lakes back to the tree where Sam Gribble lived. Have any of you ever seen a tree that big? Yep.
I think I see one in California.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The catalpa tree in the yard.
Yeah.
That's really big.
I heard building a fort. That's 200 years old.
Mm-hmm. I tried building a fort in it, but it was hollow, so that didn't really help.
Well, I was saw a hemlock tree in Alan Seeker Woods in Pennsylvania that was huge. So I made Sam go live in that. And then, about 10, 15 years later, a librarian brought me, invited me down to Tennessee, where in a museum was a huge tulip tree. Oh, and a man had lived inside it, and they had cut it down and brought it into the museum. He had a bed in it, a fireplace, and a bunch of land. I couldn't believe it. So, other people thought of living in a tree too.
So you guys made shelters today. What kind of shelters did you make?
We made a lean-to.
Yeah, like a lean-to, like tie string between two trees and lean big sticks against that string and then cover that with pine boughs.
Cool. Good. Any other questions?
I'm interested about Sam's origins. He was kind of a forgotten child in a large family in the city.
Yes. And he was going off to seek his fortune, which kids did, and not that young, but pretty much a few years older. 11 in the family was too much, and so he told his dad he was going. And his dad thought that was perfectly all right. And off he went.
Yeah, he was
going to
do it.
Yeah. Haven't you wanted to run away at times?
Yeah.
Yeah. Every now and then, life gets too complicated and you just want to run away.
Yeah. Did you get the ideas for the meals that he has in here? Did you get them from a book or did you make them?
And which one
is
that?
That is mostly my side of the mountain, but there are some on the far side of the mountain.
Oh. They're all things we did with my dad as children. So I've done them all and know which ones work and which ones don't. And it was so wonderful to be out there in the wilds and digging up dog-tooth violet tubers, and which you can't anymore, which terrible things have done, and eating them. They're delicious. Yep.
Was Sam supposed to be a big, strong child, or was supposed to be what he was pictured in as in the movie?
Was he supposed to be big and strong as a child, or was he supposed to be pictured more like the kid in the movie?
He was supposed to be a wiry, strong kid. And I know the little boy in the movie looked a little delicate, but...
Anybody
he wasn't far from the proportions of Sam, which was really my brothers. I had twin brothers who did all this, and the wiry strong, they were wrestlers, and so Sam looked like them. Yeah.
Ms. George, will you ever make any others into movies?
Will you ever make any other books into movies?
They're making Julie of the Wolves into a movie now. We've had companies and companies try to make it and give up. Now a young man who is a wildlife photographer and who loves animals and wolves will do it. He's beginning to shoot next March, I think, when the puppies are born. And he's on scene in Alaska with native people. And at last we're going to get a good bird.
That's my teacher.
Wolves are wonderful. They're just like a family. And they all get together and cooperate. And they have a language. They sniff one under the chin to say, Alpha, you're the leader of the pack. They hold their tail either up like this or down between their legs. And that means they're the lowest wolf in the pack. They cooperate in hunting. And generally are a great big family. With aunts and uncles.
Babysitters.
Babysitters. And so I fell in love with them. And everybody asked me, do you think somebody could really live with the wolves? And I refer them to L.W. David Meeks, who every year for several years went up to Alaska and lived with a pair of Alaskan wolves, right beside them. And they took him in and spoke to him every now and then, because wolves do speak. And I was able to speak to one wolf at the Naval Art Research Lab up in Barrow, Alaska, where I went to write the book. It was a female, and she had four pups, and I figured we had something in common. So I would call her, she'd come up to me, and turn away. And this went on day after day. And finally, one of the days she came up to me, lifted her head, looked me straight in the eye, which is part of the language of the wolves, and her irises grew and over the big yellow rim. And then she went, and I knew I'd talked to a wolf.